This is Radio Ecoshock with your host, Alex Smith.
When California burned in 2018, I thought of Mike Davis. In the early 1990s, Davis wrote books explaining why all this was inevitable. Davis grew up in Southern California, where he became a powerful leftist voice and a celebrated author. From The Ecology of Fear to Planet of Slums, everyone has felt ripples from his work. Mike Davis is a distinguished professor in creative writing at the University of California, Riverside, and an editor of the New Left Review. Mike Davis, welcome to Radio Ecoshock.
Nice to be on.
In your 1992 book, The Ecology of Fear, you wrote a lot about human incursion into fire areas and the inevitable blowback of wildfires into suburbs and monster homes in Malibu. How does that feel after the terrible fires hit both Southern and Northern California in late 2018?
I often write about things that personally terrify me. And I've seen Los Angeles burn and San Diego, where I now live, burn too many times not to be frightened by the phenomena. So I take no pleasure or vindication in what's happened. But these fires, and in a terrible but persistent way, underline the inequalities that govern California today, and the inequalities in terms of housing, of income, and of access to the wild areas of the state. And I recently wrote something called A Tale of Two Fires, contrasting the Paradise Fire, which destroyed 15,000 structures and killed almost 100 people, with the Malibu fire, which destroyed 1,500 structures and killed 3 or 4 people.
Yes, I know that in Paradise, California, I was talking to some folks there, and they said that it was mainly a low-income community and few had fire insurance. And now, incidentally, Donald Trump wants to cut off FEMA aid to California fire victims. My question, are the poor set up for a big fall as climate-driven disasters roll through these unsustainable lifestyles?
Well, on a global scale, I think we can speak of a kind of tirage and advance that's occurred. That basically, contemporary debates on climate change, the huge resistance not only to reducing carbon footprints, but to providing the kind of hundreds of billions of dollars of aid that are necessary to adapt the most vulnerable and exposed communities to inevitable rising sea levels and droughts and to the loss of agricultural land. Absolutely, it's first and above all a question of the Earth's poor. In California, with the wildfires, which undoubtedly have a component of anthropogenic climate change in their causality, you see two forms of inequality. In Paradise, the case of people who were unable to find housing, priced out of the housing market, even in the Central Valley. The coast has become so unaffordable. The Californians have moved into the Central Valley and other inland areas in the search of affordable housing. Many of the people in Paradise can afford even to live in the valley floor. So Paradise became a kind of attractive refuge for people on fixed incomes, for people with large families, and so on. But like Malibu, it shares the distinction of being a fire corridor, which time and time again has experienced catastrophic fires. In this case, community of 25,000 people built on a ridge overlooking the gorge of the Feather River, and backed by a notorious wind gap in the Sierras, where annually winds will come at 40, 50, even 70, 80 miles an hour. In Malibu, a similar situation in that Malibu is part of a western Santa Monica mountain topography. The canyon's perfectly aligned to the direction of the seasonal Santa Ana winds. And in Malibu, you've had areas that have been burnt 5, 6 times in the last century. Basically, Malibu burns whenever the brush, the coastal sage and chaparral, is mature enough to burn, which is why I raised the question of why should society subsidize wealthy homeowners in Malibu who have almost unlimited guarantee of fire prevention and firefighting resources in a landscape that simply wants to burn and will burn. There have been 7 or 8 major Malibu fires in my lifetime. But you can contrast the two situations. In Paradise, people with low incomes unable to really live anywhere else. And in Malibu, people with extraordinary high incomes, but most of all with formidable political clout, able to afford to rebuild time and time again, and with the guarantee that government will put all the firefighting resources it can on the line to defend their homes. A very different situation from Paradise, where all of this was circumscribed by a county budget deficit and fiscal crisis, which, for instance, prevented the widening or the building of other escape routes from this community, which had grown so rapidly in the last 20 years.
So if we want to educate ourselves about your work, should we begin with something like City of Quartz, Excavating the Future of Los Angeles? And what is the relationship between that book and the Ecology of Fear book 2 years later?
Well, one of the principal themes of City of Quartz are the consequences of unregulated speculative real estate markets on the form, the quality of life, and the democracy of Los Angeles. I engaged these issues principally in a chapter on power in Los Angeles, another chapter on the biggest social movement in Los Angeles during the 1980s and early 1990s, which were homeowners associations attempting to control growth in their communities and to protect or expand their home equity. And Ecology of Fear, the subsequent book, kind of second installment in my LA writing, I face the issue directly and show that in virtually every generation, Southern California has had prophets and visionaries who clearly saw the problems that existed at the nexus between urbanization and Southern California's wild environment, and who advocated a different model of urbanization based on greater equality of housing, but also on controlled growth that would preserve agricultural areas and ban development in the mountains. And this fire chapter talks on one hand about Malibu and their almost limitless entitlements, and on the other hand, by fire syndrome that seems now finally to have been eliminated in the city. But Los Angeles has a terrible history of tenement fires, often producing death tolls in double figures. And again, as in the case of Paradise, the fire protection available was dictated solely by city budgets and investment in fire services without the kind of federal and state entitlements that wealthy communities on the coast possess. So it's been a kind of persistent theme. I've also dwelt at great length, and in fact this explains the title of Ecology of Fear, on the systematic confusion between the social and the natural in Southern California. And I wrote it at a time when people were referring to mountain lions in the hills, comparing them to gang members, and talking about wilding gangs and predatory youth as if they were dangerous animals in the city. And so much of the confusion in the identity and practices of Southern California are rooted in basic misunderstandings of the nature of environmental processes and our particular, you know, Mediterranean climate, where environmental change doesn't come seasonally in small amounts in the kind of uniformitarian way that's characteristic of, say, New England or Great Britain, but occurs in occasional bursts, which all the kind of energy of climate and erosion and, you know, an earthquake concentrated into moments which strike people as being catastrophes, when in fact they're simply the normal metabolism, well familiar to anyone else who lives in a Mediterranean environment in Southern Europe, Cape area in South Africa, Western Australia, Chile, and so on.
Yes, I left Los Angeles in 1971 after the deadly earthquake then and never really looked back, but I still love the city. I want to move on to your year 2000 book, The Late Victorian Holocausts, and it's one of the few platforms I've found that is willing to discuss an inevitable mass death in our future. And I think we came close when Russia closed grain exports during the 2010 heat emergency and a third of Pakistan was underwater. Do you think famine will return, but this time to a vastly larger population?
Yes, I mean, and we can see this already. It's very legible, dramatically so, in the case of the Fertile Crescent in the Middle East, where epic drought and huge stresses on water supply have been integral parts of the social turbulence and violence in Iraq, in Syria, and certainly in Afghanistan. Then a drastic decrease in food security, whole areas, agricultural areas, basically been put out of commission. And the major studies of the future of drought, particularly those conducted by scientists at Lamont Doherty, the Earth Observatory of Columbia University, one of the two or three major centers of climate research, show that things will only get worse and that the water deficit in the eastern Mediterranean will increase. A particular concern is the largest irrigated agricultural society on Earth, which is the valley of the Indus River. And a lot of reports show that the water supply from the Hindu Kush and the Pamirs, basically the western part of the Himalayas, as glaciers melt and as conditions change more rapidly there than, for instance, in the central plateau of Tibet, we're talking about reduced water availability in an area where you have 90 million people dependent on the Indus to sustain agriculture. Similarly, the Punjab, the immigrants fleeing Honduras and Guatemala these days are driven not only by political violence and by corrupt governments, but also by drought. The Caribbean and Central America, another area that has been focused on by these studies. And finally, in the larger picture, to accommodate the Earth's population by mid-century, when we reach the final build-out of human population, it will never get bigger, we have to increase, almost double the food supply, increase it by 50%, yet at the same time facing these huge threats posed by diminishing water resources. Groundwater, of course, has reached far beyond the crisis level, even in innumerable parts of the world, Mexico City being a famous example, running out of the groundwater on which it relies. So we're obviously headed toward a major global crisis that conflates environmental change and disasters like floods that are one of the effects of global warming with threats to some of the most important agricultural areas on Earth, and Africa, of course, being another example. Some studies show actually the Sahara may get suddenly more rain, but the larger problem is that the Green Revolution has never really arrived in Africa, and that's more of a political and social problem, a problem of ruling elites and corrupt governments. But climate change and the return of epic droughts in parts of Africa, as we see already in Somalia, will worsen that. It's impossible to address climate change without addressing the politics of climate change. And in this sense, my book, Late Victorian Holocaust, was an effort to understand that in countries, that regions that had experienced for thousands of years periodic major droughts, why suddenly under enlightened British rule and with building railroads and canals and so on, the death toll suddenly shot up in one of the greatest mortality events in human history in the 1870s and again in the 1890s. And here you have to look not just to climate events, but to the way that water is stored, managed, distributed, and particularly the kind of resources managed or controlled by communities themselves, which were stripped away in the conquest of India and its integration in the world market by the British Empire in the 19th century.
From California, my guest is the well-known urban historian, author, and lefty environmentalist Mike Davis. I read your 2006 book, Planet of the Slums, Urban Involution and Informal Working Class. Do you see slum anger tearing down the system? And if so, can it build something new?
Well, we have to build something new. We're starting right now. I mean, the level of content of political debate around the world basically excludes about a quarter of humanity. The urgency of their needs just aren't factored in at all. And, of course, the countries whose industrial economies have created global warming will suffer far less than countries which, for political reasons, and above all to colonialism and empire, haven't developed, and whose share of global warming is very small. The burden of adjustment's entirely placed on them. And I don't think anybody can realistically look at where political discussion and action is going and have real hope that existing socioeconomic relations in any way guarantee human survival. In fact, everywhere the gates are being raised, moats being done, Trump's tyrannic proposal for a border wall is a perfect symbol of what's happening globally. That's why I've argued that we must start not from what is realistic, not what governments can agree in meetings in Paris, but what is necessary to ensure the survival and decent quality of life for every human being on the planet. And, of course, this is utopian, not because the resources and the technology exist, but because the power relations that stand in the way of that. So we have to imagine a revolution of a new kind and something that happens globally. And, of course, it would be foolish to try and specify in detail what that means. The first test is to create a body of opinion throughout the world that is absolutely committed to human survival as a whole and to restoring some balance between the metabolism of our urban societies and that of the natural world. Now, I often argue that discussions of climate crisis disguise or hide another crisis which intimately linked to the climate crisis and equally important, and that's simply the fact that global branded capitalism is no longer creating jobs for a larger part of the new cohorts of workers around the world, the new generations. Planet of Slums focused on so-called informal sector, people who are excluded from the global economy in any meaningful way, that scrape by through a huge variety of the so-called informal acts, whether that's rummaging in enormous garbage heap or pulling rickshaws or standing in front of Home Depot in the hope of getting a day's work as a gardener. I mean, the paradox for people on the left is that capitalism is no longer exploiting hundreds of millions of people, meaning that part of humanity, again, has become surplus to the global economy. And therefore, because it's also largely unorganized and has no political voice, vulnerable to the kind of decimations that we can only too easily imagine in the future.
Mike, you have defined yourself as a Marxist environmentalist. Can you talk to us about that?
I'm a socialist environmentalist. I recently wrote a book on Marx kind of to explain that I agree with Marx, who said he was not a Marxist, at least in the sense that some of his followers intended. And also, you say you're a Marxist often identifies you as associated with the academy, with Marxist thought. First and above all, identify myself as a socialist, in the belief that the people of the world have to democratically control and utilize socialized systems of production for the benefit of all. I'm extremely old-fashioned in that sense. I still believe labor should rule the earth. And that's why I always insist on calling myself a socialist. more than a Marxist. Other people call me a Marxist. But to be honest with you, a lot of Marxists don't like my stuff at all.
So what do you think of the mythology that maybe a few billionaires, you know, Bill Gates and Jeff Bezos and Warren Buffett will wake up and they'll see the ecological danger, the climate danger, and they'll start investing to save us?
Well, there's a precedent for that. In the early Depression, just after the inauguration of Franklin Roosevelt, a group of the most powerful corporate leaders in the country, and in this period of the American economic history, many corporate leaders were actually electrical engineers, like Jared Swope, the head of GE, and far more visionary than any of the current crop of capitalists, including the Silicon Valley type. And they realized that the Depression was at least partially the cause of lack of effective demand in the economy. To put it simply, auto workers weren't paid enough to afford to buy automobiles themselves. So they set out a plan that became the notorious NRA, National Recovery Administration, where industry would voluntarily agree to raise wages, in return would be allowed to set prices, pull the country out of depression. But as soon as workers began to take advantage of this and organize, and as soon as competitors refused to join the effort, it entirely collapsed and fell apart. And so even the most enlightened industrial managers were forced back to their individual bottom lines. I've argued that, in a sense, the movements of 3 or 4 years ago, the Occupy movements, were wrong-headed to stress so exclusively economic inequality. Even if you took all the fortunes of the billionaires and redistributed them, it wouldn't address the core problem. And the core problem is the concentration of economic power. That is the ability to make decisions that affect the lives of hundreds of thousands of people, to make those as private decisions on criteria of individual interests or those as shareholders. That this concentration of economic power is the problem. We have to talk about economic power, how to democratize it, and how to subordinate technological change and these vast international networks of production to human needs and to the needs of adapting our environments to a changing nature. And in a sense, there's a virtuous circle hidden with all this. Because if you buy my argument that capitalism is failing in the largest sense to create jobs for people worldwide, our current system, it's through adaptation and massive work of rebuilding our cities on green foundations that should give jobs back to tens of millions, hundreds of millions of people. When I speak to environmental groups, as I once did regularly, I always told them that there should be no environmental demand, no demand about saving the Santa Monica Mountains, for example, or creating a national park, that didn't at the same time address youth unemployment in the inner cities and involve, you know, some quotient of job creation. And it's as much the fault of environmentalists as their enemies that environmental conservation has been pitted against jobs. Environmentalists should be the most ardent advocates of employment, full employment policies.
You chronicled, as we discussed, how the British colonial system milked India, setting the stage for mass poverty. But now I see what appears to be the last vestige of communist rule in China, setting up kind of the same deal as they buy out vast farmlands in South America and Africa. Is there a big difference?
No, I don't think so. I mean, of course, China's urban industrial revolution, the largest in world history, is an extraordinary phenomenon only made possible by the competence married to the immense power of the Chinese Communist Party. But I would argue vehemently against the idea that China is anyway a socialist country, or that its Communist Party actually advances any of the principles of communism. Its staggering growth has produced huge new inequalities. It has lifted hundreds of millions of people out of poverty, but it's also deepened the wealth gap very dramatically. And the very essence of socialism is that working people themselves should exercise economic democracy. There's no way that you can really disassociate socialism and democracy. And the fact that that's so often the perception is, of course, the result of Stalinism and a variety of nationalist regimes, revolutionary regimes, that have called themselves, you know, Marxist or socialist, but in practice have been something else. You know, in the case of China, I mean, China is succeeding in some very important environmental tasks like reforestation. But at the same time, the pressure, particularly over the last 5 years, to develop land at urban fringes, land that actually is not really needed since China's been immensely overbuilding, particularly residences for people unaffordable by most Chinese, and trying to set up new industrial zones, is tremendous infrastructural investment which accrue to the profits of district officials and developers at the expense of farmland, which is needlessly converted, unnecessarily converted, basically into vacant land for future development. And it's, you know, tremendous stresses. And obviously it's become a problem in terms of Chinese goals of achieving food sufficiency. So like the Gulf countries and Saudi Arabia, it's turned to creating its own basically agricultural colonies elsewhere to export food. Chinese have been brilliant around the world in taking control of markets and primary materials, raw materials, buying up everything they can and encouraging investment and sometimes lending the money to create massive overcapacity so that the consumer, China in this case, has power, has dominance over its suppliers in Brazil or, you know, Africa and other parts of Asia. This is an unsustainable system. And whereas there certainly is some sort of Chinese miracle, there's no evidence in my mind that Chinese ruling elites are really capable of dealing with and surmounting the great problems of where economics and the environment and environmental change intersect.
Well, we're going to have to wrap this up, but I have to ask you, what are you working on these days, Mike Davis?
Well, I'm working on two things with John Wiener, well-known to many listeners as the biographer of John Lennon. We're just finishing a very large, very long book, maybe 700 pages or more, A History of Los Angeles in the 1960s. And I'm also now working on a kind of strange project called The Big Red Scrapbook, Paper Memories of Revolution and Anti-Colonialism, where I'm using basically found objects, letters, postcards, money, stamps, and assembling them much like a scrapbook and letting the objects themselves tell stories, particularly about parts of political and revolutionary history that are little known. And these are going to be mounted on the website of Verso Books in kind of weekly or biweekly installments. And I have 150 of these stories, so who knows how long that may go on.
I'm going to look for it for sure. From the University of California, Riverside, we've been speaking with the author, teacher, and activist Mike Davis. You can find links to his books and the articles we have discussed in my show blog at ecoshock.org. Mike, it was sincerely great to talk with you.
Thank you very much.
I'm Alex Smith for Radio EcoShock.
Check out the Radio EcoShock website. We're at ecoshock.org.